Have you ever wondered why mother, father, and brother all contain the z sound? No? Really? But it's kind of weird when you think about it. Now, if you already know a bit about Proto-Indo-European, and some basics of how it changed when becoming Proto-Germanic, the ancestor language of English, you might be saying something like, it's obviously a holdover from Grimm's Law, duh. In which case I'd say, yeah, partly. But it's actually a bit more complicated than just that. If before the title screen, you heard me say Grimm's Law and wondered, huh? What's that? Don't worry, I will be explaining further. In the 1700s, a bunch of people noticed Sanskrit was quite similar to Latin and Greek. And in 1786, Sir William Jones made a statement saying, the Sanskrit language, whatever be its antiquity, blah, 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 blah. I have a whole series of videos in the works on the history of the theory of Proto-Indo-European, as well as describing Proto-Indo-European itself and all of its descendant languages. But the basic premise you need to know is that all of these languages are related to one another and have descended from one common ancestor roughly 6,000 years ago or so. And by comparing all of these languages to one another, particularly the older recorded forms of the languages, ancient Greek, classical Latin, Vedic and classical Sanskrit, Old Norse, etc., we have been able to reconstruct what this ancestor language looked like in both phonological and morphological terms. Again, I have a video in the works, or out already depending on when you see this, that goes deeper into the history and the methods used. But part of this reconstructed phonology are the stop sounds, which are made up of five places of articulation, labial, alveolar, palatal, velar, and labiovelar, and three types of phonation, voiceless, voiced, and murmured. The exact types of phonation are contested to an extent, with one theory positing that PIE had a glottic arrangement, but that theory seems to have lost a lot of steam and most people have once again settled on these three phonation types. Side note, notice how I'm not using IPA, and instead of slashes, I put an asterisk in front of each sound. The reason IPA isn't used is partly because the theory of PIE is older than the IPA itself, so it uses its own traditional notation instead, but also because we don't know the actual pronunciation of these sounds, and these are just our best guesses. The asterisk here is just to mark a reconstructed element of a proto-language, so it appears in front of sounds, words, and other elements like morphemes. Now, what does this table have to do with why mother, father, and brother are all pronounced the same? Well, because these stop sounds, particularly these alveolar ones right here, eventually turn into the TH we see in father, brother, and mother. In the early 1800s, a Danish scholar called Rasmus Rask, while studying the origins of Old Norse, realized that certain sounds in the Germanic languages, particularly Old Norse, Icelandic, and English, almost always correspond to a particular sound in Latin or Greek. He saw that the Germanic F corresponded to Latin and Greek P. This character that represented the TH sound in Old English and Icelandic corresponded to the Greek and Latin T, H to C and K, and so on. Notice, however, that he correlates Icelandic B to Greek Veda, as well as theos and deus. He also notes that sometimes voiceless stops in Latin and Greek correlate to voice stops in the Germanic languages. However, stating the similarities is about as far as Rask ever went. A few years later, a German scholar made a similar connection. However, unlike Rask, he formulated rules for these correlations, and found that fricatives in the Germanic languages correspond to voiceless stops in Latin and Greek, when not led by an S or in a cluster with another stop, in which case only the first stop became a fricative. Meanwhile, voiceless stops in Germanic correspond to voiced stops in Latin and Greek, and voiced obstruents in Germanic correspond to Latin fricatives and Greek aspirated stops. Now, the reason I say obstruents instead of stops or fricatives is because, unlike the other two changes, where we are confident that they became fricatives and stops respectively due to their realizations within the daughter languages, we're much less certain about the phonetic nature of the voiced obstruents, with them appearing as both voiced stops and voiced fricatives allophonically, depending on the position within the word. The scholar who discovered these changes was Jacob Grimm of Grimm Brothers fame. And by laying out these changes, he showed how the PIE series of stops developed into Proto-Germanic, and why English has fish, fiscas, and brother, brother, while Latin has piscis and frater. Don't mind the palatal velars in the chart, they merge with the regular velars early on. And what should have been the voiced gw sound became w word internally, and b word initially, but more on that later. So that's it, right? These rules, now known as Grimm's Law, are the reason mother, father, and brother all have th in them. They all had t in PIE, and that became th in Proto-Germanic and th in English. But the PIE t only underwent Grimm's Law in brother, because if you remember, Rask mentioned how sometimes a voiced consonant correlated to a voiceless one in Latin or Greek. And Grimm also noticed these shifts that went in the opposite direction of the rules he laid out. And, well, lo and behold, mother and father are two of these words. Piai pter and pter become Proto-Germanic moder and father. The reason for this exception is another sound shift noticed by Carl Werner. He noticed that when the voiceless fricatives were led by an unstressed vowel, they were voiced and merged with the voice obstruents. Now, English could have voiced th to th later on, much like what happened in the North Germanic branch, and what we see with brother. But the only problem with this is that in Proto-West Germanic, d became a stop everywhere, well before the voices th voiced in English. It was after this that th then voiced intervocalically alongside f and s in Old English. This intervocalic voicing actually gave rise to the knife-knives and bath-bathe alternations within English. This is the situation we find ourselves in, brother, mother, and father being brother, fader, and modor. I think everyone can now start to see my confusion from earlier on in this video. After all, D in Old English doesn't generally correspond to TH in modern English. Dead, deep, dear, ladder, bladder, fodder, etc. So after some digging, I found in the Cambridge History of the English Language, Volume 2, page 64, this little snippet. Yep, it's because Middle English d gained a new affricate allophone th, well, before a vowel followed by r, before finally splitting off from the phoneme d and merging with th. We can actually see this with a whole bunch of other examples like gather, wither, weather, etc. And that's honestly it, actually. No idea what you thought when you clicked on a video about why mother, father, and brother all shared a sound. But while I have you here, I'm going to talk about the other voice obstruents from Proto-Germanic, and how they developed into Old English, as they have a much more interesting development than just becoming a voice stop everywhere. First off, with Old English b, which can only be found word initially, as a geminate, or after a nasal. As in the transition from Proto-Germanic to English, the voiced allophone merged with the voiced allophone of F, and was consequently unvoiced at the end of a word, key example being staff. Another thing of note is that some initial Bs in English derived not from the murmured B, but from the murmured GW instead, giving us bidan, to bid, meaning to request, from GWED. Now this change isn't that uncommon, and can be seen with labial velars merging with the labials in Greek, giving us equos versus hippos. Intervocalically, murmured gw just merged with the w sound, and merged with regular g elsewhere. Speaking about g, it is kind of the problem child of the voiced obstruents. See, in Proto-Germanic, the b and the d had very similar allophonic patterns to one another. They were stops word initially, and after sonorants, but were fricatives everywhere else. The g, on the other hand, was only a stop after a nasal being a fricative everywhere else, including word initially. It was during this state that pre-Old English would undergo palatalization of its velars, causing g to become y when before or after a front vowel, giving us yield, yellow, and yesterday, as well as yiv and yift, which in most of modern English has been displaced by the Norse cognates give and gift. It also gave us words like day and way. As Old English developed, g would finally become a stop in initial positions and geminates would shorten, causing all old cases of g to become allophones of h. G would also devoice word finally. To recap, G becomes Y when before or after a front vowel. G would initially before other vowels, then G separates from G to become an allophone of H. Make sense? Well, it doesn't end there, because H then drops out of the language when after a vowel, giving rise to a whole host of new diphthongs. H also merges with F in some dialects, giving rise to forms like tough and rough, giving us this beautiful mess of a table. Anyways, I'd like to thank my patron, Max, for the support. And until the next video, I bid all of you adieu.